To respect Tanzri, you can have 30 minutes.
Thank you. Okay, moderator, fellow speakers, ladies and gentlemen. When I was contacted by Yang Berhormat Dr. Edwin Bosi to attend this forum, I was just about to leave for Pontianak. And I only returned last night. So I did not have the opportunity to read the report. However, this morning I went through the past newspapers and I think that basically the RCI had cleared the government, had cleared the main culprit, including political parties, of any wrongdoing. That is the way I look at it. Instead, the RCI pointed the finger to the civil servant. I was a civil servant for about 32 years. I cannot believe this. Because civil servants, by the nature of their work, they are, I answer your obedient servant. They translate government policies, government decisions into action. And even if they have not, even they have done something wrong, I cannot believe that the government in power, not oblivious to it for almost 40 years. So that part I find it difficult to believe. Project IC, you know, the Project ICNA, I think I don't have to elaborate anymore. All of us know it's there. When I was still state secretary, an officer, a federal officer, but he was a Sabahan, came to talk to me, came up, paid a courtesy call on me, and he said, I've got something to tell you. He was actually the substantive holder of the Director of National Relations Department, Sabah. But he was a Sabahan, he was never given the opportunity to function as a director in Kota Kinabalu. He was posted to headquarters in Kuala Lumpur until he retired. Then he told me, Simon, he said, you know, all this, and this was, I was state secretary 1988 to 1993. And then he said, all this identity actually processed and manufactured in the headquarters. There is a special unit in the headquarters, and a special officer will come to Sabah with in a James Bond bag and distribute this in Sabah. So then it made me wonder, you know, personally I don't believe that RCI or any other action taken by the government so far is the solution to the problem, because the government is the problem. And not the solution. Why? You remember late 60s, early 70s, also a lot of so-called refugees. Actually, because Malaysia is not a party to the UN Convention on Refugees, nobody can be treated as refugee in this country. But that's beside the point. A lot of Vietnamese landed in Semenanjung, 1970. Vietnamese refugees, and they are real refugees because there were war in their country. Then they were placed in Pulau Bidong. After 2 years, they all gone. This is a different standard for the refugees, so-called refugees that landed in Peninsula Malaysia. Different standard applied to the one that landed in Sabah. The one that landed in Sabah originally, as Dr. Chong has said, some were recognized refugees by United Nations, but they are still here. They are still here, their grandchildren are still here. So, deep in my heart, I don't believe that the government is seriously desirous of overcoming this problem once and for all. Towards the end of the 90s, the Chief Minister, as Chairman of the State Security Committee, went, and I was in the company of him, went to Kuala Lumpur to brief the Prime Minister that this illegal issue is a security problem for Sabah. Then the Prime Minister then said, okay, once and for all, we will resolve this problem. And they established the Federal Task Force. That was how many years ago? More than 30 years ago. Federal Task Force to resolve the problem once and for all. Why I was not convinced that that was a sincere decision? Because it took 1 year just to create the post of the head of the task force. So I think this is just to play with time, you know. And then the federal government also tried amnesty, but amnesty also extended so many times. These temporary detention centers were established in Kota Kinabalu, Sandakan, Tawau. Right? Now, this is called temporary detention centers, but this temporarily now becoming on a permanent basis. You know, temporarily in a permanent basis, because temporarily means sekejap saja, tidak lama. That this one become permanent. So, and then 1,000, I think at any one time about 5,000 can be accommodated. So, surely the government and the authority, relevant authorities, are aware of this problem. Now, when it comes to, I think Dr. Chong has been talking, and then the rest have been talking about the growth of the population. Now, in my view, the foreigners in Sabah has permanently changed the economic, social, cultural, political, cultural, and demographic landscape of Sabah forever. And I think it made me think when Dato Wilfred Bumbulin said, it is these people that will have the, you know, that may be contributing to the secession of Sabah from Malaysia. Actually, many years ago, I was asked by some people, said, what do you think will happen to Sabah 20, 30 years down the line? I said, the world is not static. The world is not static. It's always keep changing. I will not be surprised, I said, if Sabah will become part of the Southern Philippines, not because it wanted to, but because it's there. They are already here. This is what I call the reverse takeover. They are already here. No need for the Philippines to claim already. They are here already. So, now in 1970, I remember this figure because when I was still with Chuakam, and I asked one of the officers to do a bit of research on Sabah, the demographic position. 1970, the population of Sarawak was about 1 million. Sabah was about 698,000, right? Come 2004, 34 years later, Sarawak, about double the amount, 2 million. But Sabah, during the same period in 2004, it was between 3.3 to 3.5 million. So, if you use Sarawak rate of population growth, Sabah in 2004 should have only a population of around about 1.4, 1.5. If based on Sarawak rate of population growth. But why in Sabah? Almost 2 million surplus, inverted commas. Not that the locals has been indicated earlier, not that we have stopped making children, but this is like a new equity if you talk about commercial company. Injection of foreign equity. So, diluted the local equity. This, you know, because actually this legal thing I can talk for hours, and my problem now is how to put this in 15 minutes. 2002, I remember this, 34 foreigners in Kenya, all got my card, you know. And then they were arrested. And then and in 2002, my card was not even introduced in Sabah. But these foreigners already got my card. And then later on, it was investigated, checked, and it was found to be genuine. So where else genuine my card produced and issued, if not from the headquarters? Again, I think also, I remember it very clearly also, Kampung Icebox. Well, I was still state secretary at that time. 5,000, there was a big fire there, 5,000 lost their homes. And out of the 5,000, only 500 were Malaysian. And the rescue team, the late General Zulkifli, told me, you know, Simon, he said, they came out, they don't bother about their personal belongings. They only care about the M16, he said. You know, they come out with M16. So this is way back to 25, 30 years ago. So you can imagine how this has developed into today's situation. So we know Sabah is known as the land below the wind. Very romantic. No, you can easily qualify land of the illegal immigrants. And I agree, this is a mother of all problems. Of course, it is not possible to know precisely the actual number at any one time, because it is changing. When I was with the human rights, I used to visit these Paine detention centers, and on the side, you know, side tracking, I asked the people there, I said, selalu usirkan mereka ini. Oh iya, dia bilang, kita usir 100 pagi, tapi 200 balik. I mean, this is just to indicate the nature and magnitude of the problem. Now, in my view, because my time is finishing, to me, this is a national problem. But, national problem were suffered by the Malaysian in Sabah. So, I suggest we should share the illegals pro rata to all the 13 states. After this exercise is completed, then the Sabah one, what the one that remained in Sabah, all the identity cards or my card that the government has issued to the foreigners, recall, then look at it whether it was done according to proper procedure, according to law. If not, you withdraw it, then you deport those people that should not have been given, but given. Then, in my view, if you need their labor, I agree, if we need their labor, let them come through the proper channel. Then, I think basically the way I see it, it is government that created the problem. There is a saying, you make your bed, you lie on it. The government has made the bed, let the government now lie on it. You see, so far, and this is the latest move, RCI, all the previous moves, action, pronouncement, have not produced the desired result. Federal task force set almost 30 years ago supposed to resolve the problem and the word once and for all. The task force, I believe, is still in existence, but the problem is still there. The only difference is the problem is much bigger and much more complicated. So that is the difference. So far, then that is why in my own heart of heart, I don't believe that the government has serious and sincere intention to resolve the problem, because in my view, from judging from what has been experienced over the last almost 40 years, they're just dragging their feet. I don't believe that it is going to be resolved, because this is the agenda of the state of the federal government for Sabah. Why there is no, this problem does not happen in other states? Even if it does, it will be very small compared to Sabah. But I will not be surprised if a lot of this legal, illegal to start with, become legal, they have gone to the rest of the country. I remember I visited, prison in Limbang. I went to the ladies, section club, and then about 70 or 80 of them there. Baru kena tangkap. So saya tanya, berapa orang masuk Sarawak melalui Sabah? Semua angkat tangan. Berapa orang berasal dari Filipina? Lebih kurang 50. Separuh lah. And then yang the rest all from Indonesia. So, Sabah is the gateway to Malaysia, the gateway to the world. Now, as far as this committee is concerned, you know, in government it's very common, based on my experience, and that reflective of me also. When there is a task to be done, and nobody wants to take responsibility, they will form a committee. The committee will meet, and then the committee will form subcommittees. The subcommittees will report to the main committee, and then it will go on and on and on. Anything good, they have the competition to claim credit. When something is no good, everybody pointing finger at the others except themselves. So it is something like this, and I'm finishing now. I just tell you this is about four people. Their names are everybody, somebody, anybody, and Mr. Nobody. There was an important job to be done, and everybody was asked to do it. Everybody was sure somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it. Nobody did it. Somebody got very angry about it, because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody would not do it. It ended that everybody blamed somebody when actually nobody asked anybody. Thank you very much.